Good morning. My name is Susan Reardon. I'm the staff hearing officer, and I call this special meeting of the staff hearing officer on Wednesday, May 31st to order. Today, we just have one item on the agenda, but before I get to that item, I have a couple of preliminary matters I need to get through. The first one is requests for continuances, withdrawals, postponements, or additions. This item is scheduled, and we will hear it today, so there is no continuances. Under announcements and appeals, I have no announcements, and there's been no recent appeals. And then is there anyone in the audience who would like to address the staff hearing officer on items not on today's agenda? Seeing no one, we'll go to the first item, which is a notice of hearing to suspend or revoke the application of Joseph Allen. And the subject of this hearing is to consider whether to suspend or revoke the medical marijuana storefront dispensary permit application approved by the Planning Commission on June 4th, 2015 for Santa Barbara Municipal Code Chapter 2880. So the order of this hearing, this is actually a new hearing, but I'll have the city statement and submission of evidence testimony first, so the city staff will come up, followed by the applicant's statement and submission of evidence, and that'll be both for Mr. Allen and for Mr. McGee and Mr. Armour. And then I'll have open the public hearing, and then I'll give each of you an opportunity to rebut by the city and the applicant, and then I'll ask questions of you guys. Okay, so we'll start with the city. If you'd like to come up and give your presentation and introduce, I would like to introduce Scott Vincent, who's the assistant city attorney, who's assigned to be the attorney for this item.
Thank you, Staff Hearing Officer Reardon. So again, my name is Scott Vincent. I'm an assistant city attorney with the city of Santa Barbara. I do land use planning with the Community Development Department. I will be advising today the staff hearing officer on matters of evidentiary and evidentiary matters, as well as the application of Santa Barbara Municipal Code Chapter 2880, the storefront marijuana, the storefront collective permitting ordinance.
Okay, great, thank you. I'd like to state your name for the record.
Good afternoon, or good morning. Tava Ostringer, Assistant City Attorney. I'm going to be representing the city with regards to the notice of intent to suspend or revoke. And with me is Tony Bauman, Associate Planner. Some housekeeping issues. The parties had a pre-hearing meeting, and we were able to come to some stipulations with regards to facts and evidence. With regards to the evidence, the parties have stipulated that there is no objection to any of the city's records as provided in their binder, evidence numbers 1 through 25. So everything's in without objection. With regards to the evidence submitted by Mr. Luis Esparza on behalf of Greg McGee and Matt Armour, there is no objection. With regards to the evidence submitted by Mr. Velez on behalf of Joseph Allen, there is an objection with regards to Mr. Allen's Exhibit B, and no objection to any other exhibits. Did I state that accurately? And Mr. Esparza can state his objections when it's his chance at the table. With regards to the facts, the parties have agreed to stipulate that there is no objection, and the facts are as stated in the city's statement of facts. So those will stand for the record. So Well, I understand that we do have the stipulation with regards to the facts. Just for the benefit of the public and the record, I did want to go through quickly a few background issues so that we're all up to speed. I think the key issues are, we know that the application for the marijuana dispensary permit at 3617 State Street was submitted on September 4th, 2014, the applicant being Joseph Allen. The original application identified three management members, Mr. Allen, Greg McGee, and Matt Armour. The collective entity that was identified in the application was Santa Barbara Patients Collective and Healing Center as a nonprofit association, unincorporated. The application, after I think two revisions, was deemed complete by the city on February 25th of 2015. The application also that was deemed complete identified three management members, Joseph Allen, Greg McGee, and Matt Armour. The collective entity was Santa Barbara Patients Collective and Healing Center, an unincorporated association. Each of the management members executed a statement under the penalty of perjury that the facts and application was complete and everything therein was true. The application also identified certain grow locations, cultivation locations. This completed application was heard by the staff hearing officer on the, I believe it was May 28th of 2015. The staff hearing officer approved the application with minor modifications, none of which altered the management members or the collective entity. The Planning Commission, under its authority under the Municipal Code, suspended the staff hearing officer's decision and took it to the Planning Commission on June 4th, 2015, to determine whether to uphold the planning, or excuse me, the staff hearing officer's decision. At the hearing, after testimony and staff presentation, they approved the application as submitted with the minor modifications that the SHO had required, plus 10 conditions that they also required. So the application was approved, but the permit before vesting required that 10 conditions be met, or conditions subsequent. That was June 4th of 2015. None of the 10 conditions related to or authorized changes to the management members, namely Joseph Allen, Greg McGee, Matt Armour, nor did it authorize a change in the collective entity from the unincorporated association. With that being said, the applicant then on December of 2015 submitted articles of incorporation to the state that incorporated an entity known as Santa Barbara Patients Collective and Healing Center, the same name that the unincorporated association is. This was done without the knowledge of the city. Then on March of 2016, the applicant Joseph Allen also submitted a statement of information for the incorporated entity, and in that statement of information it identified Eric Anderson as the secretary of the corporation. Following that, on April 4th, the applicant submitted an application for review to planning, and at that time, that's generally when the city became aware that there had been a change in the collective entity. It had gone from an unincorporated association to an incorporated association. The operating agreement also identified that there would be a change in the name of the incorporated association, an amendment to the articles that would change the name to Apothecary Inc. It was noted that in the operating agreement, Mr. McGee and Mr. Armour had been removed as management members. Two new management members that had not been approved by the city were included, and that would have been Eric Anderson and I forget the second name, Lorenzo. Neither had been approved. There was a later attempt to change the cultivation locations, which had not been approved. And it was at that time that the city issued its, in July of 2016, issued the notice of intent to suspend or revoke. So this brings us now finally to the argument. There really isn't in this case a dispute of the facts. There's a dispute of how those facts are going to be applied to the municipal code. Section 2880.130 of the municipal code, Section A, requires that a permittee of a dispensary get an amendment to an application that's approved by the community development director and that goes through all the same steps that they would have taken to submit the original application before there can be a transfer of control or the permit. And I draw your attention, it speaks specifically as well to control of the dispensary. The management members, by definition, are those individuals that are approved to organize, control, and generally run the dispensary. In this case, there was also a collective entity that was identified as an unincorporated association. That was later incorporated. A corporation has its own distinct rights, just like a person does, so that change was substantial. And with the change in the members of that corporation, also resulting in a change in who can control, by definition, the operation of that dispensary. So these changes should have been done by way of an application for an amendment to the city, and that didn't happen. I think the rub that we've all noted in our briefs, all parties, is the issue of who is the permittee here. And in this case, the permittee can be the applicant, but it can also be all of the members. The definition of permittee is one who is identified by the applicant as a management member who is a permittee or members. In this case, I have to recognize that the application that was deemed complete by the city did not identify a permittee, and in that case, the city probably should not have deemed this application complete. Had there been an identification of permittee, there would have been a more clear understanding of what the transfer of ownership was with regards to Section 130. However, I do think it's clear that whether it was a permittee or not, there was the change in ownership and attempt to change how this dispensary was controlled. And with regards to Section 130, we have to recognize that at this point in time, this permit hasn't vested yet. While the application was approved, the 10 conditions have not been satisfied, so we don't necessarily have technically a permittee. So if the staff hearing officer can't find that this would be an applicable code section that would automatically void the attempted transfer and cause an automatic revocation of the permit, I think it's clear that we can fall back on to Section 2880.120, which authorizes the staff hearing officer to suspend or revoke the permit for violations of any conditions of Chapter 2880. And as there's no dispute in the facts, I think we've all agreed that there was an attempted change in management members, attempted change in the collective entity. There was an attempt to, a request to change the grow locations for the marijuana. All of this should have been done by way of an amended application. And whether it was done with the intent to misrepresent or just it was a simple mistake, I'll have to let you decide. However, it is clear that there was clearly attempt to change the membership. I don't want to oversimplify this, but the Planning Commission reviews an application in its totality, and that's what they base their decision on, and that's what they rely on, and they're approving. And because this is the sale of marijuana, which under state law is legal for medical and now recreational purposes, I think there should be a higher scrutiny, and that's why there's probably the code is written the way it is to require these amendments that are a little more stricter and tough to maneuver around. The public deserves to know what's out there, just as the decision makers deserve to know what they're approving and who they're giving this permit to. So for that reason, I think it's clear that there's no reason why not any of this should have been done without an amendment and without it going at least back to the staff hearing officer. That's the intent of the code, and that's clearly the way it's written. So for that reason, if it's within your discretion to revoke the permit, there was this attempt to wiggle around, for lack of a better word, the Planning Commission's approvals. If you can't find that this raises to the level of a revocation, we would ask that at the minimum you suspend it with the condition for reinstatement that that the application approved by the Planning Commission be submitted with all of their 10 conditions met, or that an application for a complete application for an amendment be submitted for consideration, and that all of this occur within 30 days. Failure to submit a completed application that meets the Planning Commission's 10 conditions or a completed application would be deemed revoked without need for further hearing. And I believe that Mr. Vallis has requested that if this a suspension were granted, that the two-year requirement to get the permit issued be extended for a year. I would object to this only on the grounds that the date that the time period ran would have been June 4th, 2015, when this Planning Commission issued or approved the application, and it started to toll on July 19th, 2016, when we issued the notice of intent to suspend. So that period between July 19th, 2016, and whenever the staff hearing officer issues the decision would be the period that could be told. All right, thank you.
Good morning.
Morning, Ms. Reardon, Mr. Vincent. I think there's a green light.
Nope,
now there's a green light. Okay.
Good morning, Ms. Reardon, Mr. Vincent. This is Fernando Velez. I'm representing the applicant, Joseph Allen.
And I'm Joseph Allen, the applicant.
Thank you. As the city attorney noted, we don't have any objections to any of the evidence submitted by any of the parties. We note the objection to Exhibit B. I'll address that later. I think Ms. Ostringer's summary of the history is accurate, but we disagree respectfully with her conclusions that we were trying to get around any sort of procedure. I think the narrow issue here should be, can an applicant for this permit change that application and amend it? We believe we can. We believe there is that Joseph Allen is the applicant as defined in the statute. The city has continually identified him as such. The city has required the applicant to make changes to the operating plan before the permit is issued. The city, in fact, in the order approving the application, authorized the applicant to operate the dispensary in accordance with the operating plan. We would agree with Ms. Ostringer's statement that there are 10 conditions subsequent to the permit, which have not been fulfilled, so there is no permit issued at the moment. We think because of that fact, there can't be a transfer of this permit. We think, therefore, that Mr. Allen, as the applicant, has the ability to change this application as he wishes until that permit is issued. Not as he wishes, you know, we do want city approval for this application change, and attempts were made to flag these changes to the city. Mr. Allen pointed them out in his memo to Mr. Bowman, and then he highlighted them in the amended operating plan submitted to the city that caused this issue. The hope was that every single change to this operating plan doesn't necessarily require a public hearing, and we would ask the hearing officer to either grant Mr. Allen's changes, requested changes, or we would agree with the city's remedy of issuing a suspension for 30 days and allow the applicant to make changes in the procedure, to make requested changes in the procedure you require. We'd be happy with either remedy.
I would simply add that by proposing these changes to the city in April of 2016, what I expected to happen was that I would get back an email or something from the planning department telling me how to formally submit the changes that I had referenced in my email to Mr. Bauman. Because since the actual permit had not issued yet, because we've spent a lot of time getting various things in order, I thought, as of April last year, that I would get back an email saying your proposed changes need approval by the staff hearing officer, or that because the last body to act was the Planning Commission, you have to submit a request in a certain form to the Planning Commission or something. What I got back was an email from Mr. Bauman, which was perfectly courteous and friendly, acknowledging that he had received my suggested changes, and that he would be in touch. The next thing I heard about it, and of course, because of that, I went on about my business and thinking that if there was a procedure I needed to follow, I'd hear about it in due course. The next thing that I heard was in July, when the city sent out the first notice that the city attorney's office thought there should be hearing about suspension or revocation. I'm a little puzzled as to how a permit that was never finalized can be either suspended or revoked. But leaving that to one side, I'm the one who advised the city of the facts that the city has now brought to you. So I don't think I was trying to conceal anything from the city. I think the worst that can be said is that instead of presenting an entire formalized, amended application and operating plan. What I did was send an email saying, these are things I would like to do. What do you think? And the matter has rested there basically for 13 months. With regard to managing members, I want to make one thing clear. Removing the name of a managing member from a city application does not remove a managing member from a role in the organization. Okay? This is a very important distinction. There is no requirement in the city code that managing members, as distinct from the applicant, be named in either the operating plan or the permit application. In fact, the only other permit that has received approval, the permit relating to Canopy at 118 North Milpas Street, is an application and operating plan that contains one singular name, the applicant in that case. The operating plan in that case, just like the operating plan in my case, refers to the fact that there will be city-approved managing members and that one of those managing members will be on-site at all times when the dispensary is open and operating. But there are no named management members in the Milpas Street application, and I cannot find any requirement in the city code that managing members be named in any of the operating documents. The city's requirement for managing members is that they be residents, that they be over 21, that they be qualified medical patients, that they pass a background check, that they submit to a live scan procedure carried out by the city police department, and that they not have been previously found to have committed various kinds of crimes or infractions, particularly with regard to operating dispensaries in the city of Santa Barbara, or I suppose anywhere else. The suggestion that I made to the city in April of last year was not to revoke the status of Mr. McGee or Mr. Armour as managing members of the dispensary. It is my intention to submit additional managing members, and we can talk about how that might be done, but the dispensary, in fact, cannot operate in conformity with the city code if it has only three managing members, counting myself. The portions of the operating plan which have not been changed and which we do not propose to change require that a managing member be on site in control of the operation 6 days a week from 8 in the morning to 6 in the evening, which are the approved hours of operation. One of the two existing managing members other than me, Mr. McGee, has indicated that his primary interest in contributing to the dispensary is as a cultivator. And that's fine. He is a skilled cultivator. He has a good reputation for the quality of the cannabis that he has grown for himself and others in the past, not yet for us because we're not yet open. But it will be apparent to anyone who considers the matter that Mr. McGee cannot be out in the fields cultivating cannabis for the dispensary and simultaneously be present in the store on State Street.
I need to remind you, this is a hearing for suspension and revocation. It's not for a revised application.
I understand. I understand.
If you can focus on...
Yes. I'm trying to draw the hearing officer's attention to the fact that Mr. McGee and Mr. Armour have not been removed from anything. All right. Now, with regard to the corporate and name change issues, I did indeed submit paperwork in, if Tava says it was March, I'll take her word for it. It was somewhere shortly before April, because in April, in my emails to Mr. Bauman, I referenced the fact that current advice that I had received said that the best way to manage a dispensary under California regulatory law is to have the dispensary incorporated as a California nonprofit mutual benefit corporation. Okay? So I submitted paperwork to the state to do that, and I advised the city that I would like the city to approve moving from the unincorporated form to the corporate form. Now, frankly, I can't imagine any substantive objection on the part of the city to running the dispensary through a nonprofit corporation as opposed to an unincorporated association. What significance the city would attach to that change of organization escapes me. But again, I didn't simply unilaterally do that. I told the city that I had created a vehicle that I wanted to use, and I expected the city to come back to me with some advice about a procedure to do that. With regard to cultivation locations, I should reference an important but sad fact that I think Fernando didn't know and that therefore isn't in our submission to the city. Tava pointed out correctly that I had told the city in April of 16 that I wanted to add Lorenzo Diaz and Eric Anderson as additional managing members. Mr. Diaz has since died. He did, in fact, submit to and pass a live scan procedure before his death, but he died suddenly and prematurely last fall. With regard to cultivation locations, it is certainly true that as time goes by, we will be submitting to the city requests to approve additional cultivation locations. If there is some particular procedure the city thinks should be used to submit additional cultivation locations, I would love to know it so that I can do it the way you want it done. The reason for this is that the usage of land changes over time. Land changes ownership. Owners change their desires for the use of their land. Land that an owner thought was okay to cultivate cannabis in 2016 may no longer be available for that purpose in 2017 or 2018. For a dispensary to avoid disruption of its supply chain, a dispensary needs multiple city-approved cultivation locations so that if a particular location drops out of service, there are sufficient locations available that an interruption of service to the patients will not occur. Finally, the request that I'm making, which I made to the city in April of 16, and which I still am requesting, is to adopt a business name of Santa Barbara Apothecary, which, as I previously stated, I also wish to have as a nonprofit mutual benefit corporation. The reason for that is twofold. One, it's good marketing. Apothecary with its reference back to the apothecaries of the 19th century.
Again, this isn't on revisions to the application. This is on the revocation.
I understand. But the city somehow got the impression, as Ms. Ostranger stated to you, that by seeking to use a new name and seeking to form a corporation, I was somehow going behind the city's back and doing something to change the entity under the application without the city's review and approval. I'm trying to explain that that is not so. There were good reasons for doing this, and having decided that it should be done, I told the city I would like to do it. I'll be happy to respond to specific questions from the hearing officer that may arise in the light of what anyone else wishes to say. I would just add that I agree most wholeheartedly with what Fernando said, that what I would like to see happen is the staff hearing officer decide that none of these things became final without city approval, suspend the existing application, and give us 30 days in which to supply an amended application and an amended operating plan for city review.
So if I, okay, yeah. And so if I'll just summarize, we do believe that there is no permit. Joseph Allen is the applicant. As the applicant, we're requesting changes to two sections. The removal of Mr. McGee and Mr. Armour as managing members and designating Mr. Allen as the permittee and replacing unincorporated association with a newly formed entity. And in my letter brief, I explained some reasons for that. With regard to the objection by Mr. Esparza to Exhibit B, we believe that the objection relates to, if you'll notice, the plaintiffs are Patrick Formey and Santa Barbara Patients Collective Center, Inc. We believe that was a mistake on the plaintiff's part. The note is, in fact, the note that's attached to that complaint is, in fact, signed by the unincorporated association, by Patrick Formey, as an authorized signatory, which is another reason why we'd rather use a newly formed entity with no financial or other issues and with a clean financial report that we can start reporting, making the required reports to the city. We do not have insight into this unincorporated association. And so we believe that that was just a mistake by the plaintiff. We'll agree with the city's request to suspend this application for 30 days and let us make these changes in the formal method that you require. We don't think that Mr. McGee or Mr. Armour have an interest in this application. They are not the applicant. And the center, the collective that Mr. Allen originally wanted to use, he'd like to replace with another collective, and it'll be there'll be no interested parties harmed there. The collectives can't earn money or profit anyway, and that collective appears to be operating its own business anyway. And we're happy to answer questions. Thank you.
Mr. Esparza, if you want to come up.
Thank you.
And state your name for the record and who you're representing, please.
My name is Luis Esparza. I represent Matt Armour, Greg McGee, in addition to the nonprofit association that has been referenced, the Santa Barbara Patients Collective and Health Center. And I believe that last point's important because there is a little bit of clarification I'd like to make to the statement of facts. It sounds procedurally sound in terms of what's happened in terms of correspondence and developments. But there seems to be some confusion as to the status of this nonprofit association. Some of the comments from the applicant and council seem to imply that the association authorized or passed a resolution to incorporate. And that's not true. This nonprofit association still exists. It still has two of the original three members. That is why I represent it. And they are at least an interested party here. They were part of the approved application. And whatever entities the applicant has formed subsequent to that have no relation to this association. The association still exists. It did not merge. It did not incorporate. And the applicant is obviously free to go form as many entities as he desires. But that association still remains. So that's one point I wanted to clarify with regards to the stipulation to the facts. Along those same lines, my objection to Exhibit B of the applicant's brief relating to that lawsuit is based on that fact that the named defendant is a corporate entity, association is not. I'll concede there is a note attached to that complaint that appears to reference the nonprofit association, but one of the big questions is, so what? You know, there's an alleged debt out there. It's my understanding that it's being addressed, and it shouldn't have any bearing on this application, nor should it be cited as a reason to form a new entity. And if the association did incorporate by passing the authorized resolution, then it's a success. The resulting entity is a successor in interest. And would have previous debts and assets that it had before. So from the perspective of my clients, Mr. Armour, Mr. McGee, and the association, we have, for lack of a better term, a rogue applicant. Things changes were made that Mr. Armour and McGee were not aware of, and the explanation seems a bit self-serving. On one hand, it's, well, I didn't know I should have done that, or these things had to be approved. But on the other hand, we're hearing a lot of expertise on the ordinance and familiarity with a lot of the provisions in the ordinance. So it's still unclear as to why it happened. We do agree with the applicant that Mr. Armour and Mr. McGee have not been removed of anything. They're still management members of that association. What has been attempted to be removed is that association from this application. And our position here, by not being the applicant, I feel is a bit limited. I think it's limited to clarifying and explaining. But at the same time, asserting the fact that Mr. Armour and McGee do have an interest. You know, their title is at a minimum, according to the ordinance, management members. And they were identified as such in the approved application. Whether they're a permittee or not, I don't think is a dispositive issue. There seems to be questions about the jargon and whether a permit has vested or whether a permit has been issued. But in my brief, I refer to the permit and application kind of interchangeably or refer to them as the same item. But there is a lot of uncertainty as to what has occurred, and I think I just want to reiterate on behalf of Mr. Armour and Mr. McGee that they were not in agreement with the new entities being formed. They feel the nonprofit association was part and parcel, part of the application, and of the approved application, and any suspension that allows for changes to be made should include a restoration to that. To that form. There's a lot of other interesting questions that may or may not result to the grounds that the city is relying on to either revoke or suspend, specifically 28.80.130. Given the comments on the association and the fact that there are two of the original three management members, Our position is that there is no change in ownership. Well, no ownership because it's a nonprofit and nobody technically owns it. So the key word in that ordinance provision seems to be a change of control. And I guess it just depends on what context it's looked at. Within the context of the application, there is a purported change of entity, whether that constitutes a change of control. We would request that it does not. The association's there, it's ready to be part of this application. It does not run any existing business. There is allegations in the brief as well by council that this association is operating a different business, and it's my understanding that that's not the case. And along the lines of clarifying a bit, there was I believe it was Exhibit C to the applicant's brief, which appeared to be a judgment for unlawful detainer. That was the first time I'd seen that, as well as my clients. And it was obtained by default. The one thing I wanted to note there is that I'm not sure if it was served properly. We're exploring options to address that if need be, such as setting aside the default, if there was, in fact, notice issues to my clients. And to clarify, I mean, the applicant stated that he did not unilaterally make any changes. Well, the association did not. It's my understanding there was no resolution. The board of the association did not meet to authorize any sort of incorporation or the formation of a new entity, or any changes to the application for that matter. The changes were unilaterally made. And that raises a whole host of other issues. In terms of titles, it's clear the applicant is who he is. It was clear that my clients were the management members of that application. It's unclear whether the applicant was acting as the association's attorney at that time or as my client's attorney. He was an attorney in good standing back then. And so those are things that there's still in clarity, but with regards to the grounds for this hearing and the limited issues, I just want to reiterate that Mr. McGee, as well as Mr. Armour, and to an extent the association, because this association, again, was identified as part of the approved application. I think I use that term part and parcel because I've heard Mr. Vincent advise in another hearing that's the way these applications are handled, and the management members aren't just some minor personnel that can be removed at the whim of the applicant's desire. They're an integral part of the application, and because of that is why our request is that if the city is inclined to revoke or suspend, that any suspension be conditioned on a restoration of the original form. I think it's the least that the association and my clients are entitled to, even if they do not have vested rights in any given permit. That's the request as interested parties, as management members, and as an integral part of the original application. So with that, another point on the permittee issue, even though it might not be a dispositive issue, like I mentioned, if there is no permit, there may not be a permittee, but the ordinance doesn't seem to require that the permittee be identified as such, i.e. as a permittee. The permittee is identified as management members, so I think it necessarily follows that if the management members are identified in the application, it's natural to assume that those management members identify as will be the permittees. All along, my clients as well as the association understood that because of them and the entity being an integral part of the application, that they would always be the permittee if and when the permit was finalized and issued and vested, that it wouldn't just be in the name of the applicant, that it would inure to the benefit of the association. So with that, I'll rest with my comments, but I'll be happy to continue the theme of clarifying and answering any questions that may assist the hearing officer to make your decision.
Great, thank you. I'd like to open this public hearing. I do have one request to speak. I know a couple other people have come in the audience. If you would like to address the staff hearing officer on this item, fill out a request to speak. And with that, Mike Jordan.
Good morning, Mike Jordan. So you know I have some background with this process. I'm a city planning commissioner and the liaison to staff hearing officer, but I'm just talking today as an individual. And I agree with the city attorney that we have an ordinance that's written specifically for these type of uses for a reason, and it's not that we should be holding them to a higher standard. We are holding them to a higher standard, and clearly something's amiss here. There's an applicant that's got internal conflict going on and expects us to resolve that with our ordinance, and has painted our ordinance as clumsy, I think was the word used. And I can't imagine that when we drafted the ordinance that we would have imagined that it would have to apply to what's going on with the applicant right now, that it's attempting to change ownership and attempting to do that in a manner that's contrary to the ordinance. I can clearly see a remedy being revocation. I agree with the staff recommendation and the city attorney. But in all fairness to the applicant, too, they've been through a staff hearing officer hearing, maybe more than one, a planning commission hearing, and were approved. And I would suggest the following. I would suggest that you give them an appropriate amount of time as determined by the city to resolve their internal strife. And then remedy what is the glaring inconsistency with a couple of these approvals based at that time, and that was that there was no input from law enforcement, from the Santa Barbara Police Department, into the security plan of this operation. We had a police chief at that time that declined to do so, and city management that somehow were unable to force him to do so. And the current situation is the police chief will provide input on security plans and operations. And I think we would all agree that the goal of the ordinance is to have the best possible operation on the ground that protects the community, the applicant, and its employees. So if the applicant was agreeable to both of those, I think that would be the path to move down. And if the applicant is not agreeable to both of those, I think there's certainly adequate information here to revoke. Thanks.
Great, thanks. I have no other requests to speak forms. I would like to note I did receive two letters from neighbors. The subject of their, they're in opposition to the dispensary, but the subject of their opposition is not the subject of this hearing. They were just against the addition of a medical marijuana dispensary in this location, so that's not a subject of this hearing today. So I'll close the public hearing. And it's on to questions for myself. And thank you for your presentations. It did answer a lot of my questions that I have had. But I do have some additional questions that I don't believe were covered. And so I think I'll first go with Miss, how do you say your last name?
Ostringer.
Would you like to come up to the table? Okay, so there's been testimony on both sides and on your side regarding the permittee and who is the permittee. And Mr. Velez has indicated, and also in his brief, that that the applicant didn't, or the application did not actually specify a permittee. And so there seemed to be stating that since there wasn't one specified, that Mr. Allen was the applicant, so he's the permittee. But when I read the ordinance regarding the definition of permittee, it says the management member or members identified to the city by an applicant as such and to whom a storefront collective dispensary permit has been issued, and someone who also qualifies as a primary caregiver. So it seems since there was not an actual person designated as the permittee, and there were three management members in the operating plan, that all three of them are the permittee, right?
That's what I argue in my brief, yes. I believe that's the correct interpretation of the code section.
Okay, so if that's the case, and Mr. Allen voluntarily resigned from the association, so, and the revocation is based on the actions of Mr. Allen, but if he's no longer part of the association and the permit was granted to the management members, why doesn't the permit remain with the, why in the city attorney's opinion the permit doesn't remain with the nonprofit association?
It would probably remain with the remaining management members who would be the permittee holders, because the permittee has to be a management member. I believe that's Mr. Esparza's argument is that there's two remaining management members. There was a removal of Mr. If you follow the resignation of Mr. Allen, then there would be two remaining. There was also the attempt to change the entity and add additional by Mr. Allen, which happened before his resignation, which would have... Okay. The incorporation occurred in December of whether it follows it, whether it was the incorporation of the association as it existed, or it appears more likely that it was an incorporation of a separate entity outside of the unincorporated association. That occurred in December of 2015. We know it around March at least. That's when the statement of information was filed, that there was an addition of Eric Anderson as secretary to the incorporated association.
Okay, then another clarification. I don't know if it's for you or Mr. Vincent. The whole, and you said it in your comments too, but I just want to clarify. So when you look at section 2880.070, and it says criteria for review of a collective dispensary application by the staff hearing officer. It says, upon application for a storefront collective dispensary permit being deemed complete, the staff hearing officer shall either issue a collective storefront dispensary permit, issue a storefront collective dispensary permit with conditions in accordance with this chapter, or deny a storefront collective dispensary permit. In this instance, I acted on it, or the staff hearing officer acted on it, brought up to the Planning Commission, they acted on it, so that would be the same for the Planning Commission, could do all these things. So the Planning Commission issued a storefront dispensary permit with conditions. So wouldn't that mean the permit was issued? Now you're bringing into other elements that it's not vested because they didn't comply with the conditions, but quite often decision makers approve an application and add a number of conditions.
The permit couldn't, and Scott will probably advise you on this later, our argument is the permit is not issued. It's the application is approved subject to conditions. The permit itself can't issue until each one of those conditions has been satisfied. So they have a right to continue on and seek that fully issued permit mm-hmm. as they go along and do more work. That right to that permit and that approval begins to vest, but it doesn't fully vest until each one of those 10 conditions has been satisfied.
Which would mean until a building permit's issued? Because that's the way we do it. When you comply with the conditions, you need to comply with them.
That's one of the conditions in the resolution. Mm-hmm. There were 10 separate regarding modifications to the right. operating agreement, so mm-hmm. there were 10 of those. So they could technically do those 10, submit the operating permit and application, and that would look good. They still have to go through the process and get the building permit.
Okay.
And then that, because that's another condition.
I think that's all my questions for you. Thank you. Mr. Velez, would you like to come up? Okay. In your brief, you you bring up the complaint from Cannabis Royalties and Holding Corporation versus Patrick Formey. And when we look at the promissory note, he's the one that signed it on half of the collective. And so I was just wondering, what's your understanding and his role in the collective?
My understanding, mm-hmm. in his words, is that he runs the collective.
Okay. Because I noticed, Mr. Allen, too, in your letter, in your Exhibit 15, page 355. You address your resignation letter to Matt Armour, Mr. Greg McGee, and Pat Formey. So that's the reason why I stressed to all three, because he's part of the association.
I'm sorry, what's the question? I have the exhibit.
Okay. What is your understanding of the role of Mr. Formey in the association?
I don't know what Mr. Formey thinks his role is in the association.
Okay, and why did you
include him? Mr. Formey, together with myself and Mr. McGee and Mr. Armour and some other people whose names don't appear here, all played a part in originally deciding to make this application. I'm not aware of any documents. If there are any, they've never been shown to me or copied to me, that give Mr. Formey any particular office with the association. As far as I know, he's never been appointed secretary or treasurer or something like that.
But he signed a note, a promissory note, in the name of the association.
He did, and my position is that that was an act of fraud, that he misrepresented himself as having authority on behalf of the association to take out that loan. The proceeds of that loan, so far as I know, have never been deposited into a bank account in the name of the association. I've never seen any accounting of what has been done with the proceeds of that loan. And this company in Canada that lent the money to Mr. Formey, is suing him to get it back, which is why we put the Exhibit B to Mr. Velez's brief. So, legally speaking, I don't know what Mr. Formey's role is. I included him in the letter dated April 6th of 2016, because I had become aware that he was doing some things allegedly in the name of the association, and I wanted to distance myself from what he was doing, both what I had learned he had done, namely the loan, and also from whatever he might be doing that he wasn't telling me about.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can I elaborate on something that Mr. Esparza said? Is it time for rebuttal?
No.
No.
Because I started, maybe I jumped the gun. Oh, yeah, you could have rebutted. But I'll continue with my questions, and then because there may be some rebuttal after that, too.
Sure.
Okay, Mr. Allen, you say you're the applicant and you prepared all elements of the application packet, or?
I prepared all the elements of the final version, yeah.
So in preparing the packet, you read and understood the requirements of Chapter 2880?
I certainly read them. I believe I understand them.
Okay. So exhibit one, page 49 through 51, where it says it's the statement that Ms. Ostringer said that says this for all three of you. I, Matt, and then it says Greg, and it says Joseph. Under penalty of perjury, have personal knowledge of the information contained in the dispensary application, that the information contained herein is true and correct, and that the application has been completed under the supervision of Joseph Allen. So how was it determined? There's this association. Did they vote to allow you to submit it, or was there something in writing that gave you the authorization to submit the application, or was it just more verbal that you had the expertise, you were the lawyer, you're going to act as the applicant?
It was a verbal understanding. I don't think we ever created a resolution or something of that nature. We all had input on different paragraphs of the application and the draft operating plan. Many of those paragraphs were straightforward. A few of them required some discussion. And I approved the final version before submitting it to the city.
Okay, so there wasn't any actual, like, association review and a formal, okay, it looks good.
No, but remember, we're talking about a very small group of people here.
Mm-hmm. You're also pointing to one of the issues with using an association like this. There's very little in the way of how to govern them. Mm-hmm. No bylaws. I mean, this is one of the problems. Who's the authority? How do they make decisions?
Okay. So on Exhibit 7, page 247. Your discussion underneath Santa Barbara Municipal Code 2880-130B says transfer of a permitted collective dispensary permit. Your discussion starts off with Santa Barbara Patient Collective Healing Center will not transfer ownership or control of our storefront collective dispensary or attempt to transfer our collective dispensary permit to another person. So can you explain what you mean by that? Because that, it sounds like it's acknowledging the permits with this association.
Perhaps I can address that.
Okay.
This is page 26 of the application, page 247 of the exhibit book. This is a commitment on behalf of the unincorporated association that it will not attempt to transfer any permit once it issues until the hearing process, which is referenced in that paragraph, has been completed.
Okay, so what it says, I'm just going to say the association, so I don't have to say all the words. The association will not transfer ownership or control of our storefront collective dispensary. So the association's not, okay, the permit, all parties agree that the permit hasn't been issued, but the control of a dispensary it's acknowledging that it wouldn't be doing it, and it's acknowledging it knows that there's supposed to be a hearing to transfer that.
Yes.
But you're saying the transfer of control didn't occur from the association to this new corporation?
It hasn't yet occurred.
But what was the article of incorporations that was submitted in December?
Well, I can address that. It's one of what Louise said. We concede that was not a merger. That was not a decision by the association to incorporate. That was a newly formed entity.
So it was transferring it from the association to the corporation. Control
no.
of it.
No. There was meant to be no link. And so what we are requesting is an amendment to the permit, I mean the application, to issue the permit to this newly formed entity. We didn't intend to imply
In your testimony to me beforehand, Mr. Allen said that the changes were submitted When submitted, changes expected planning to tell them the steps to make them. I don't have any of that evidence in my binder. I just have, here's my revised operation plan. These are the changes I made. I don't see in my documentation that there was a request to what do I need to do to make these changes. It was just, these are the changes we made.
Well, as this paragraph points out, the changes cannot become final until the city approves them.
Until the staff hearing officer approves them.
On behalf of the city.
Right. So I don't see a request in here that's asking for that change. It's just stating that change occurred. Am I missing something?
Well, we did acknowledge that if we made the wrong procedure here.
Okay. We did. Yeah, you wrote all that in writing, but in the testimony I heard that you had requested the change failed to outline the steps for you.
No, Mr. Allen mentioned that was his expectation. The requested change was part of an iterative process. There was multiple back and forth between the planning department and Mr. Allen.
Yes.
And we are acknowledging that we did not submit this approval to the staff hearing officer.
Okay. Yeah. So it's not staff's fault that they didn't tell you what to do. You prepared the application. You understood our ordinance and what was required. Now, the steps to implement it may not have been real clear, but it says specifically in there that the staff hearing officer needs to approve the changes.
But your question presumes that the permit's issued. We still don't concede that.
It says control. Transfer ownership or control. So it
right.
means the ownership or the control. I don't. Okay.
Our position is that we still have an application outstanding. Okay. And we'd like to amend that application.
Okay.
And the purpose of the incorporation was to create an entity to which the staff hearing officer could approve transfer of control of the dispensary. We couldn't ask you to approve a transfer to a thing that didn't exist.
Okay.
So I created it. Then I prepared amended documents. I submitted the amended documents. I advised Mr. Bauman what I was trying to do. And if my subjective expectation matters at all, I expected to get a notice of hearing about the amended documents. Instead,
but there was never a specific request stating you wanted to change it from the association to the corporation, right? It was just included in the operation plan.
Correct.
Okay.
Well, I mean, unless correct that we did not flag it as a requested change. It was among other changes.
So that's what I meant by that. Okay, great. Thank you. That was questions for you. Mr. Esparza, if you'd like to come up. I'll ask you the same question in regards to Exhibit 1, pages 49, 50, and 51. When Mr. Armour and Mr. McGee signed these, what was their understanding of what they were signing? What did the affidavit mean? Do you know? Or should I ask them to come up?
Well, they are not present. I mean, I'm familiar with the exhibits. And
maybe get closer to the mic.
I think that those statements under penalty of perjury, I think, were part of the application. I think they're required to show that all management members are aware of what's going on, are okay with what's going on. But I think further, the statement, the way it was written, and even though it's also signed by the applicant, saying that he did it under the supervision of himself, speaking in the third person, that the association, the management members, entrusted the applicant to do this. And that's one of the big things that stands out from our perspective, is that as management members, as possible permittees, here we are in a hearing of suspension revocation through no fault of their own. You know, they feel they don't know what they did to get us here. But to try to answer the question, it's my understanding that they signed that to reflect an understanding of the contents of the application, an agreement with the contents, and that it was a required part of the application, that statement under penalty of perjury flows from one of the requirements in the ordinance.
Do you know what role they had in the preparation of the application?
I do not know the details as to the tasks and the works that went into the application, no.
And then I asked this to Mr. Allen and Mr. Velez. Do you know if they signed any document authorizing Mr. Allen to be the applicant, or was it just verbal?
Other than the statements under penalty of perjury, I'm not aware of any other documents authorizing Mr. Allen to act in any regard, whether it's as an applicant or attorney or otherwise. I'm assuming that due to the small number of participants that it was somewhat informal. And there's just a general understanding of what was to be done up until the changes, because that's where the understanding seems to end.
Okay. And you kind of, yeah, I think you, my other question was related to Exhibit C of Mr. Velez's brief, which you kind of touched on in your presentation, that you don't, actually, can you explain your position on Exhibit B?
Well, only that in the applicant's brief was the first time I had seen that. It was the first time I became aware of it. It does appear to name the nonprofit association as a defendant in the judgment for unlawful detainer. But in conferring with my clients prior to this hearing, there seems to be issues with service and whether they had an opportunity to respond to that complaint, which is why I stated that I may be acting on that if it's appropriate. I'll look to that and see if my scope of representation also entails filing a motion to set aside the default. It very well could be unnecessary, moot. We'll see. I think time will tell as to what happens with that, if anything. But the one point I did want to get across is that they were unaware of the judgment being entered.
Okay. And then I asked this again of Mr. Allen and Mr. Velez. What's your understanding of Mr. Formey's role in this association?
My understanding, I've heard him referred to as a consultant. I'm not sure if that's with regards to dispensary operations or cultivation or both. Like the applicant stated, I have not seen anything that gives him any specific authority or title in the association, such as a board member or secretary and treasurer and the like.
But it sounds like this is all informal anyways.
Well, the membership of the association is another term, like a lot of the jargon in the ordinance and at issue here, that depending on how you define it, can be very expansive. I mean, in a management perspective, it just refers to the board and any officers, and officers aren't necessarily required. In a larger sense, members of the association could very well include all the qualified patients, all the future customers of the dispensary. They are very likely, from one perspective, members of the association as well. Clearly not management, clearly not president or treasurer and the like. So whether Mr. Formey is a member of the association, he very well could be, as any qualified patient would be, or primary caregiver. But I'm not aware that he has any management title or authority. And so therefore can't speak whether that note was entered into with the express authority. I don't have any information regarding that.
Could you get that information?
I can confer with my clients as well as the association and see and try to answer that in a more specific manner for you. Yes. Specific the question specifically being to ascertain his title, role, or authority with regards to the association?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And what allowed him to sign on the behalf of the association here? Okay, you said in your comments that in regards to the actions that Mr. Allen took, that the board didn't authorize the changes, but one of you two had said that. Can you elaborate on that? Because I was asking, did the board authorize Mr. Allen to submit the application?
The approved application that they were part of, yes. And clearly they authorized that, were part of it, were aware of it. They signed those statements under penalty of perjury. What I was referring to when I believe the comment you're mentioning that I previously stated was that there was never any resolution by the association to incorporate, that the formation of the mutual non-benefit corporation and now the suggested formation of yet another entity. That they had nothing to do with that. And I believe the city's exhibits explain that specifically, the letter, Exhibit 21 from Mr. Armour, as well as Exhibit 22, which is a notarized correspondence. I believe that accurately states their position that they were neither aware or in agreement with those changes that were made. And that's just one of the unfortunate aspects of this situation from their perspective.
Okay, great. Those are my questions. Since you're sitting up here, did you want to go first with the rebuttals? Or should I go in the same order?
I think if we can go in the same order, I'd prefer that.
Go ahead.
Tave Ostringer, Assistant City Attorney. I'll be brief. I only have two. I do disagree with Mr. Allen's comments that the municipal code doesn't require that management members be identified in the operations plan and application. Their section 2880.060F provides that storefront collective dispensary applicant shall also provide the following management member and collective information of a storefront collective dispensary application. The name, telephone number, title, functions of each management member. It goes on to provide that those management members will provide a statement under the penalty of perjury that the information contained in the dispensary is true and correct. That is what Mr. Allen, as the applicant, did in the application that was deemed complete. He identified, and on behalf of McGee and Armour and Mr. Allen, each of them as management members. A management member is a collective member with the responsibility for the establishment, organization, registration, supervision, and oversight of the collective. So it was Mr. Allen's choice as the applicant, along with his co-managing members, who was going to be managing this association. They chose that. The city didn't require them. It's not, you can have one management member, but in this case, they specifically chose to have three and include three in their applications. With regards to whether or not the city should or would have objected to the change to an incorporated entity, whether we would or should have or could is the point. We weren't given the opportunity. That's the whole process. The staff hearing officer should have the opportunity to make that decision. In this case, that wasn't there wasn't an application to amend to make that change. The applicant, Joseph Allen, incorporated an association that included new members and submitted that after the Planning Commission had approved the permit. With regards to Exhibit C in Mr. Vallis's brief, I'd like to point out that the lease for the property was in the name of the association. Mr. Armour and Mr. Allen both signed on behalf of that unincorporated association. I believe they were both the guarantors of that lease, but the lease is specifically in the name of the association. The notice of default identifies the unincorporated association as being ousted from the property. These permits are site-specific under Section 2880-130A. So if there's no longer a lease or the right to be at that property, we no longer have a place for the permit to issue. So that was all. Okay.
Okay, Mr. Velez.
Thank you, Ms. Surgeon. I'll be brief as well. With regard to Louise's, Mr. Esparza's comments, again, like I noted prior, we didn't mean to imply that the association somehow merged or approved with or became the new incorporation. That was a newly formed entity. So it wasn't intended to be a successor in interest. Mr. Esparza references the lawsuit from the Canadian company against the association and Mr. Formey and says, so what? We disagree that that's irrelevant and meaningless. As the applicant, if the applicant becomes the permittee, he's required to make quite a few, he has quite a few reporting obligations to the city, including financial. We have no insight into what the center did with the $100,000 we've asked. We have no records about the center's operations we've asked. At the time the application was prepared and those affidavits were signed in 2014, those were believed to be true. This was 2 years later, we're now 3 years later. We've learned things. And, you know, so we believe the lawsuit is, in fact, quite relevant. And we'll point out that the attorney for the center hasn't figured out exactly what the money went. He also hasn't figured out Mr. Formey's role with the center, although the center is his client. And Mr. Armour and Mr. Gee aren't here to state their interests, which was typical of this entire process. Mr. Allen did the laboring share. Mr. Esparza wants to refer to the permit and the application interchangeably. We disagree. There's an application here. Mr. Allen has been continually referred to the applicant as the applicant. And the approval itself says that the permit will be issued with, I think it was 10, I'll take Ms. Ostringer's word, 10 conditions subsequent, which means the permit has not been issued. With regard to Ms. Ostringer's statements, I think, well, I'll leave aside the management members issue. We agree that the permit is site-specific. The center has been evicted. Mr. Allen tried to work with the center and Mr. Armour. I know they were aware of the eviction proceedings. At least he was. And no one helped with that eviction proceedings. The landlord does wish to work with Mr. Allen and has informed us that he will either support this application and we can provide an amendment with a new lease or a new application at the same site with Mr. Allen in charge. So the center has no rights to this space. And so if the center is determined to be the permittee for some reason, then we would agree that the permit is revoked. It is site-specific. We'll concede that. That's all.
Okay, thank great.
You.
Thank you.
Mr. Allen, sorry.
I was just going to agree with the point about the permit being site-specific. The 10 conditions from the Planning Commission approval, as Ms. Ostranger correctly observed, have not been satisfied. I don't recall at the moment how many of them have and how many of them haven't, but it's certainly clear that not all of them have. And in the meantime, after the expenditure of a great deal of money on my part, the landlord revoked the lease, and we have the judgment. I don't know what Mr. McGee knew about that, because he was up in Oregon most of the winter and early spring this year. I do know that Mr. McGee was personally aware that the landlord was seeking to evict the Santa Barbara Patient Collective and Healing Center and to terminate the lease on which Mr. McGee and I were indeed both signers and guarantors. Mr. Armour. Yes, sorry, not Mr. McGee.
So Mr. Armour was
Mr. Armour and I signed the lease. Mr. Armour and I personally guaranteed the lease. The tenant was the unincorporated association. The landlord, Rick Doolittle, served me with a copy of the unlawful detainer and posted the property first with a notice to pay rent or quit, and then subsequently posted the property with a notice of the summons for the eviction case. I know that Mr. Armour was aware of both of those documents because he and I met and discussed them. I didn't choose to contest the eviction, and apparently Mr. Armour didn't either, although he wasn't obligated to tell me if he was going to contest it or not contest it. But he didn't contest it. That's the state of the case file over at the courthouse. Nobody contested it. No answer was filed. Defaults were entered, and presently Mr. Doolittle obtained a default judgment. So that lease has been terminated. It is correct that I have since met with Mr. Doolittle. Mr. Doolittle has indicated that he is quite happy to work with me and execute a new lease to me individually for 3617 State Street. And I've indicated to him that I'm willing to do that at the point where these issues that are here for decision have been resolved.
Great. Thank you. Okay, Mr. Esplaza.
Ms. Reardon, I'll be brief as well. And I come back to the plain language of the ordinance and what I think are the narrow issues of this hearing, because there's a lot here that is potentially inapplicable, if not irrelevant. My clients, the individual clients, are the management members and therefore the permittees. Whether or not a permit is issued, we contend an approved application can be referred to as a permit. And as you stated in section 28.80070A, a decision was made on the application. So if a decision has been made, you know, arguably it's been issued. So if it's issued and they're permittees, again, my clients have rights here, you know, but yet we're here at this hearing for relating to actions that are not their own. With regards to Exhibit C and the lease, I think it's just curious that the landlord counsel who obtained that judgment is the same firm as the applicant's counsel. So it's not surprising to hear that he's stating that they're willing to work together and only with him. And they have the same law firm. So with that said, I just encourage the city, if there is enough basis here for either suspension or revoke, to err on the side of suspension to allow an opportunity for this application to go forward as it was approved, including operation plans and the lease and so forth. I think with some time will tell whether that's possible.
Okay, great. Thank you. Sorry, it's in regard to Mr. Formy and his role in the association. Specifically, as I talked to Mr. Esparza, he signed a note on behalf of the association. Mr. Formy has had experience in this. We've had experience with him running another dispensary in the city, so it is something I would like to find out what is his role, how he was authorized for signing on behalf of the nonprofit organization, and if that information, I'd need that information shortly. Within the next 5 days. Could you get it then? And then I'd issue my decision within 10 days after that. The other outstanding issue, but I think it's been answered, is in regards to the association, how they authorized the submittal of the application, because the contention here is Mr. Allen saying he's the applicant and the permittee. Mr. Esparza is saying that they're all the permittees. I'm trying to figure out how, but I think the answer has been given, that there wasn't a formal action by the board, that it was informal, got together, discussed it, this looked good, and this submitted. Is that correct? You're shaking your heads.
Yes, that's right.
Okay. All right. So in regards to that, I think that's my last outstanding issue. But I do have a question in regards to what Mr. Jordan brought up in his suggestion of that if it is suspended and give the applicant given a time to submit a revised application, can additional conditions be placed on the project regarding operational and security plan? Or is it really limited to the change of corporate association of corporation, changing the name and changing management members?
Ms. Staff Hearing Officer, the notice of revocation or suspension speaks to particular issues associated with potential changes to the control and potential changes to the growing sites without the appropriate permitting process. If there is a suspension and the application is therefore continuing but suspended, then I would say that the only conditions associated with such a suspension should address those violations that were noticed. If there's a revocation of the application because of the noticed violations, then any subsequent application would need to comply with the entire process, including the approval of the security plan by the chief of police. It would have to go through a new application de novo.
Okay. Can you come up to the table, please?
Just with regard to the point about the police, the applicant is quite willing to work with them. So if that just takes a stipulation or something, let us know, you know. Yeah.
And carry out their recommendations that they may have? Any revisions to your plan?
No, I'm presuming they'd have input and revisions, and we would absolutely put them in if it's workable. Yes, yeah.
Great, thank you for that clarification. Then the last question, Scott, said, I think procedural. If I believe I've asked all my questions that I have now, but if I'm preparing my decisions and briefs and I have an additional question, the process would be to submit it to all three of them for response, if I need an additional clarification on something.
Madam Staff Hearing Officer, at this point, my answer to that question would really depend on the nature of the question and how and what whether it is susceptible to a simple either submission of a simple answer or if it really requires the opportunity for each of the parties to have an opportunity to kind of hear the answers and go back and forth. So if there are simple questions, I believe we could submit those questions to all three of the parties and you could submit your answers. We would do so in a stipulated process. If any of the three parties were to object and want to have a continued hearing in order to respond to that question, then I think we would need to schedule a new hearing.
Okay. That makes sense. All right. So you will get me information regarding your knowledge of Mr. Formi's role.
I'm sorry, did you ask that of me too?
If you have any additional information that you could submit, yes, within 5 days, which would be by next Wednesday, we'll make it easy. And so with that, I'll adjourn our meeting.
So if the parties can, do the parties stipulate to having that one, the week from today to submit any information regarding Mr. Formi's role in the association and his authority within the association within that week, That would be the time frame to submit any information if you have that, and then with an understanding that would start the clock, starting after Wednesday of next week, there would be the 10-day period for the staff hearing officer to render her decision.
Understood and so stipulated, and I'll note that I'll make the effort to ascertain that starting forthwith right after this hearing.
Agreed.
We agreed.
Thank you.
Thank you for the clarification. So I adjourn the meeting.